my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. Today, I wanted to give you an update to the series that I do on PhD applications, and this is an update for 2025-2026. There's a lot going on in the world of academia, and I thought I'd give you some insights about how that's affecting the PhD application process and timeline. So let's jump on in. So first, let's lay a foundation of the PhD application landscape. Why would you even get a PhD? Is it worth it in 2025? I think that the cost-benefit analysis has changed a little bit for future years. In the past, honestly, it was a pretty safe bet to get a PhD, safe-ish, in part because there was financial stability, it will give you an edge in the market. If you want to pursue academia, you're open to doing that and going in industry. So it's really a way to make sure that all the doors are open to you. That is still the case to some degree, but I think there's more costs associated with getting a PhD. The truth is that PhD is a long period of time. We're talking 5 to 6 years that you're dedicating to this discipline. It is gonna be more competitive to get in, and then the resulting jobs that are just for PhDs and not for anyone else are going to be smaller and more competitive as well. So I'm talking about things like directors of research programs, being a professor yourself. Those are things you can only get if you have a PhD. Those jobs are shrinking to some degree across all different disciplines for various reasons going on around the world and in the US as well. So I think you want to think about that. I think there's a bigger risk for getting a PhD, but I will say you have to think about timelines. If you're thinking about applying for a PhD program, you're talking about 5-6 years down the road, and we truly do not know what will be going on in 6 years. What we see in terms of an outlook for the next 2 to 3 to 4 years is definitely a shrinking of some of these opportunities based on the funding that is available, but that might not be the case in 6 years. So my major point here is that there's just more uncertainty. And if you're someone who was on the fence, it wasn't, you know, a major thing that you really wanted to do, you might be shifted over to not wanting to pursue a PhD and pursuing something else with that time. During that 5-6 years, you could begin a job in a particular role, and over time you're going to advance in that role. Whereas if you had a PhD, you're just getting that PhD during that time. So it's definitely a risk. But I would say that if you're someone who's genuinely interested in the work of a PhD, the activity of it, definitely still do it. There's lots of chatter online about having to be independently financially stable. I don't think that's necessarily the case, particularly if you're going into a STEM field, because the PhD is a paid job, essentially. You're gonna either be a TA or you're gonna be funded on a grant, and that is gonna be your salary. Now, the salaries aren't great, but that is, you know, something to live off of. I personally was okay with the salary that I got in my PhD, which wasn't that long ago, but I came from a lower middle class upbringing, and so it was actually pretty good. I've done a lot of jobs in my lifetime. I've been a janitor, believe it or not, ski instructor, and the salary I was getting as a PhD student, my stipend, was better than all of those previous jobs. So I actually thought it was amazing that they would pay us to do work that was really invigorating, that ultimately led to something better for me, which is a PhD. So that might not be the same calculation for you based on, you know, your family situation, which city you're living in, but I definitely don't think you have to be independently wealthy to start a PhD. You do have to be okay with the salary that is provided. Okay, so let's talk about actually applying for the PhD. How is that different? What has changed? The overall summary is that it's just more competitive. There are going to be fewer positions available because there's less funding available. So it means that you're just going to have to compete more. You're going to have to be the top of the applicant pool. I have several videos on, you know, how to increase your chances of getting accepted. I think in 2025, 2026, I think professors are going to prioritize a sure thing. It's going to be less likely that they will hire people that they have never encountered before. In the past, there's this little bit of a gamble where you would get all these great student applicants, and maybe you haven't met the top applicant, but you're willing to roll the dice and see if they're great, because that might be high reward. It's also high risk. I think what's gonna happen is that professors are going to be very risk averse moving forward. So that means that making yourself a sure thing is really the name of the game. There's a few things you can do for that. One is meet the professor or potentially work with them previously so that they know that you work well together. The elements that are a gamble include, does the professor like working with you? Can you work well together? Do you have the skills to do high quality work? Are you going to have the drive to do high quality work? So as much of that as you can reduce the uncertainty in, the more likely you will be to be selected for those fewer and fewer PhD positions. Now, unfortunately, that means that you're gonna have to do a lot more groundwork than you might have done in previous years. And I would encourage you to do an application process where rather than applying to many, many different places, you focus in on several specific places that you invest a lot of time and energy into. That involves meeting the professor, getting more FaceTime with them, asking to do collaborations, maybe asking them to advise on a thesis project. All of those things really make it more likely that you will be successful working with them, and they will know that you're a sure thing. Now, that makes it very challenging if you're coming from industry or another field into academia. That's another risk that you bring to the table because you might not like it. You're probably gonna have to take a salary cut to go back into graduate school. And you don't have the infrastructure of the university to support those collaborations. You're not doing a thesis, right? So you can't ask them to advise on a thesis project. So I think that is even more challenging for individuals coming from industry. If you are coming from industry, one of the things you can leverage is that you are probably more of an adult than more junior, younger applicants. So it might be easier to work with you. So what you can do to kind of begin to build those relationships is leverage conferences. Independently, go to conferences that the people you're wanting to apply with are at and try to have meetings with them. You will come off as professional, prepared and ready to engage in this process because you are a little bit older and you have some more life experience. So that can be a really great way of being more of a sure thing than maybe someone who comes right out of an undergrad and they've never had a real job and, you know, they're not sure if they're committed to this. It's just they're doing the next step. If you're coming from industry, you are clearly articulating that you have made a decision to make a life change that is hard. And so you can leverage that to be more of a sure thing. Another major thing that is going to be a bit of a challenge is it's going to take more work to figure out who actually has PhD positions open. I would say from my personal observations, people who tend to hire students are doing it more conservatively. So what I've noticed is that faculty who would normally accept a student, assuming they will get some type of funding for them, are not. So they're not making any assumptions. If they have money right now, they accept a student. If they don't, they're not going to. So you could generally assume that there's certain faculty or groups that are hiring PhD students about every year. You should not assume that to be the case anymore. And so you want to reach out to people as early as possible to see if in fact they do think they will be accepting students. They might not know at various times, but starting that conversation early is really important. People often ask me, when is a good time to start that? I think the semester before is good because then you have time to build relationships. If you have an opportunity to connect or do in-person meetings, that's really good. I think at the beginning of the summer before you want to apply, I think that's an ideal time as well, in part because people are just getting off their summer semester, so they're still around their emails and they're not fully on vacation mode just yet. The time that is too late is probably September, but in any case, you're gonna have to do a lot more cold emails. It's gonna take a lot more work to find the people who actually do have funding or plan to accept graduate students. Speaking of funding, that's going to be a bit of a change in 2025-2026. By and large, most universities have a student union, or the students are unionized. So the actual PhD salaries are set by that contract. And certainly if you're already in a PhD program, this isn't affecting you. But what you may start to see is that more people open up options of self-funded PhDs. This is where you don't actually get a stipend, you don't actually get a TA, you're just allowed to do the program essentially, and you're self-funded. So do not do this. I think that is a trap. And we've seen it in the past, but I just think we'll see it increasingly more. I think if you're having to pay for a PhD, I think that is just honestly a bad deal overall. I mean, it is a great education, of course, but I think hold out for positions that have paid PhD salaries that you get from either TAing or it's off a grant. Don't go for any of these self-funded PhDs. Another thing for funding is that it was always an option for you to bring in your own grant funding. There are several mechanisms where students can secure grants for their entire PhD process. That is fantastic because then your potential advisors don't need to care if they have money at all. It's just a great fit. You know, that's how they decide if they want to work with you, because you're bringing in your own money. That is going to be harder and harder. Classically, there was an NSF GRFP that you could apply for as a graduate student. Those are severely limited, so those will be more competitive as well. Everything's just more competitive. That's what we're seeing. Definitely search for those opportunities, but they will be more competitive, and you'll want to do more preparation for those as well. The last thing I'll talk about that's new for 2025, 2026 is that you will just see the faculty and professors and the graduate students that you're working with be more stressed. It is a stressful time to be in academia. Lots of things are changing, and you will just notice that it is a complicated time. I think getting a PhD is always stressful, maybe just as stressful, if not more, than other jobs. I don't necessarily think it's harder, but it's certainly very emotionally demanding. And I think being in academia right now is a pretty emotional time that you'll see, you know, all around the world, not just in the US. So just be prepared for an environment that might be a little less certain, and that's at all various levels of it. Things might change in the upcoming years, but I think it is a time of uncertainty, and that's really stressful for everyone. So I thought it'd be fun now to answer some questions that I found online about this particular topic. And these are from the last year or so. So this one is from the subreddit AskProfessors. Interesting Pen 45 writes, "Dear professors, are you paid only $60,000 a year?" Some are, okay? That's shocking, I know. Some are. I think that liberal arts schools, particularly in non-STEM fields, have lower salaries like this. I'm certainly paid more than that. In most STEM fields, you're paid higher. And the way that it works is that professors get paid different amounts based on the departments and the schools that they're in. So there's a whole range of different salaries. But often public institutions tend to get paid less than private institutions. And sometimes liberal arts schools get paid less as well. And yeah, it can be sometimes as low as $60,000. But the numbers you see online are a base salary for 9 months of pay. We can also, if we get grants, which are more and more limited, get summer salary to work on those grants over the summer. And that can be, you know, a third of the base price added on top of that. We also generally get paid for conference travel, or at least our grants pay for that conference travel. So there are a ton of perks, but yeah, the salary is not the best. The next question, do you believe any person with average qualities can earn a PhD? I say yes, okay? In part because I am a very average person. I wasn't extraordinary in school. I went to a very low ranked undergrad. I have dyslexia, okay? I have low working memory capacity. There's nothing inherently special about me. What I have that helped me get a PhD is grit. So I never gave up. With all of the obstacles and pitfalls, I just kept working through them and working through them and working through them. And lo and behold, I got a PhD, okay? So I don't think that there's anything special about me. I think if you truly want to get a PhD, absolutely do it. 2025, 2026 are kind of crazy times right now, but if you want to get a PhD, go for it. The thing you need to have is grit, and all of these other obstacles, they will happen. There will be new obstacles that come, but if you truly care about the activity of getting a PhD, you can absolutely do it. I did it. And I really think anyone who has the drive and interest can get a PhD. All right, the last question is from the subreddit AskAcademia. Checking on my fellow academics, anyone else feel like they are losing it a little? I would say that's the main vibe from academia and, you know, all my friends across all the institutions. That's both within the US and in other countries too. It is just a wild time. And I think part of it is that each week there's new news coming out that directly affects us. So we're trying to keep it together. It's a little bit crazy in academia because as a professor, all of the news that comes out affects me and the people that I'm responsible for, like my postdocs and my PhD students. So I'm deeply trying to ensure that they have job stability, that they're gonna have good job prospects, because when they started this journey, they had no idea what was going to happen. So there's really a lot of pressure to ensure that, you know, my work is continuing and all of the people that I'm responsible for are going to be successful. And then thinking about accepting new people is also stressful. Yeah, so it's a crazy time. I think that it hits different people in different fields in different ways. So if you know an academic, please be kind to them right now. But this craziness isn't unique to academia, I don't think. I think a lot of people are being affected by various things going on in the world right now. So just be kind to everyone and we'll all get through this together. If you like this video, please consider hitting the like button and subscribe for more content on academic success. Take care.